Hello everyone. The topic of today's discussion is oral squamous cell carcinoma. So today we'll be discussing about the etiopathogenesis, the epidemiology, and the histopathology of oral squamous cell carcinoma. Also, we'll be studying various grading system for oral squamous cell carcinoma. So before starting with this term squamous cell carcinoma, we'll be using few terminologies in the upcoming slides, which are used interchangeably, such as neoplasia. When we talk about neoplasia, neo means new and plasia means growth. So any new growth which is produced is known as neoplasia. Also, this is replaced by another term, tumor. Tumor in literal meaning means lump or a swelling. So we can use the term neoplasia or we can use tumor. Also, there is another term which is used interchangeably is cancer. When we talk about cancer, cancer is derived from the word crab. As the crab has its arms and it can grasp the host, in the similar way, cancer has the propensity to infiltrate or to invade into the adjacent structures which are close to their vicinity. So, in the upcoming slide, we'll be using the term neoplasia, tumor, and cancer interchangeably. However, they have different meaning. Also, there is a term oncology, which is known as the branch of science that deals with the study of tumors, cancers, or neoplasms. Because oncos means tumor and logos means study. When we talk about the definition of neoplasm, whenever we see that whenever there are growth signals and there is stimulus, the cell starts proliferating. But what if the cell keeps on proliferating even if the stimulus is removed? So the Willis has defined the neoplasm as an abnormal tissue proliferation which is uncoordinated and it keeps on proliferating even after the cessation of the stimuli. So, cancer is a multifactorial genetic disease which results from the excessive and the unregulated proliferation. So, it does not require any kind of growth signals. It does not require any kind of stimuli. It will keep on progressing without any stimulus because it is a result of accumulated genetic changes. So, when we talk about the normal cell proliferation, the normal cells proliferate and mature under the control system. So, we have labile cells which keep on proliferating throughout life. We have another group of population which are stable cells which show limited proliferation and undergo resting stage. Also, there are some kind of cells which once have differentiated, do not replicate further. They are known as permanent cells. Whereas the neoplastic cells or the cancer cells, they lose their control of replication. They keep on progression and this attain a property of autonomy. They do not want any stimulus. They will proliferate throughout life in an abnormal manner. When we talk about neoplasm, we have two categories. It can be benign, it can be malignant. Whenever anything is benign, we have to keep in mind it is slow growing, it is localized, it will not cause any kind of discomfort to the patient or to the host system. No pain, no discharge, nothing. Whereas if it is malignant, it shows the rapid progression, it spread throughout the body and it will present itself like in the form of pain, in the form of local discomfort, in the form of discharge, necrosis, hemorrhage, and sometimes it may lead to the death of the host. So when we have to categorize the lesion from benign to malignant, we have to see its clinical presentation, its growth, its macroscopic, followed by its microscopic appearance. So when we talk about the population of cells, usually tumor arise from a single cell population. So they are known as clonal. However, they can be monoclonal. Some cancers may be polyclonal also. Now starting with the squamous cell carcinoma, where we talk about the most common malignant neoplasm of head and neck, we have to keep in mind it is squamous cell carcinoma and comprise of about 90%. Whereas when the term is malignant neoplasm of salivary gland region, the answer is mucoepidermoid carcinoma. We have already discussed it in the previous discussions. So we have to keep in mind what is the question whenever it is asked in MCQs, that the most common malignant neoplasm of head and neck is squamous cell carcinoma. Whereas if it is salivary gland, then it is mucoepidermoid carcinoma. Now this squamous cell carcinoma is divided into the histological gradings of in situ lesions, superficially invasive and deep invasive based on their penetration, their invasion pattern, and based on their histopathological presentation. When we see them clinically, they can be in the form of ulcer, they can be flat, there can be polypoid growth, there can be varicose growth, it can be endophytic or it can be exophytic, or it can have both the components. So it can show varied presentation clinically. When we talk about its clinical parameters, it is more commonly seen in males. When we talk about the age predilection, it is seen in middle to later decades of life. The important risk factors to the squamous cell carcinoma can be tobacco and alcohol, which can be in the form of smoking tobacco or smokeless tobacco. There are some other factors such as immunocompromised host, the environmental factor, and the occupation factor, which also may act as a precipitating factors for the development of cancer. There are some certain other etiopathogenesis which plays a role in its pathogenesis, such as viruses, for example, human papillomavirus, Epstein-Barr virus. But not all the individuals who take tobacco or alcohol or who are exposed to virus get cancer. So it is the genetic predisposition which plays a major role, and these factors may act as a secondary hit so that cancer can develop. So when we talk about the site, the most common site in the oral cavity is the tongue. When we talk about the sinonasal tract, it is the maxillary sinus, and in the larynx, it is the glottis. So we have to keep in mind that in the oral cavity, tongue is the most common site which is affected from oral cancer, and the growth which is seen on the surface can be ulcerative, it can be flat, it can be exophytic, it can be endophytic, or it can be in the form of papillary projections. The appearance of the tumors can be erythematous. Sometimes it can be white to tan. When we see the histopathology, as we have already discussed, that in cases of dysplasias, we see dysplastic features such as cellular nuclear pleomorphism, increased NC ratio, prominent nucleoli, increased mitotic figure. Same features will be seen in cases of squamous cell carcinoma, but here they will be denoted as anaplastic features. So there will be disorganized growth, there will be loss of polarity of the nucleus, there will be dyskeratosis, there will be numeral keratin pearls, there will be increased NC ratio. So all these features in squamous cell carcinoma will be considered to be anaplastic features, and they will be high in number in comparison to dysplasia. Also, at the junction of the tumor and the stroma, there will be dense inflammatory infiltrate, which will chiefly have lymphocytes and the plasma cells. So when we talk about any kind of tumor, it has basic components. One is the parenchyma, which makes the main proliferation of the neoplastic cells. So these parenchyma is composed of basically the neoplastically altered or the transformed cells, whereas the stroma is the supporting connective tissue which surrounds the tumor mass. So the parenchyma determines the nature of the tumor. For example, if the tumor is of fat cell origin, it will be called as lipoma. Similarly, if it is of collagen fiber, it is called fibroma. If it is epithelial in origin, it is called as carcinoma. So it is the main tumor mass which forms the major population, and that will determine the parenchyma or the nature of the tumor. Now, when we talk about the epidemiology of the cancer, it is the sixth most common cancer in the world, and the most common site which are involved in cancer can be lips, tongue, gingiva, mouth, parotid, and other salivary gland. And when we talk about the death rate, it is about 1,45,000 per year. So coming on to the characteristics of tumors, these neoplasms can be categorized clinically and morphologically into two categories broadly, benign and malignant. For example, the first thing is rate of growth, whether it is rapid or it is slow and intermittent. Second is the cancer phenotype. Third is their clinical and gross appearance. Fourth, their microscopic features. And last is the invasion and metastasis, which is a cardinal sign for malignancy. So when we talk about the rate of growth, the malignant tumor cells will have increased mitotic rate. So they will have increased doubling time, whereas they have slow death rate. So they will keep on increasing again and again, and there is decreased apoptosis. When we talk about the degree of differentiation, as the tumor progresses, the differentiation decreases. So the poorly differentiated tumors will show aggressive pattern, whereas if a tumor is well differentiated, it will be less aggressive in comparison to poorly differentiated. When we talk about the cancer phenotype, the normal cells will grow under normal growth controls. It will perform their function, such as the stratified squamous epithelium has a function to form keratin. then the normal cell have a balanced rate of cell proliferation and cell death, and they are socially desirable. However, we talk about the cancer cells, they do not obey any kind of growth signals. They proliferate autonomously. There is rapid growth. There is imbalance between the proliferation and the death. There will be excessive growth and they will lose the property of differentiation. So the higher grades of cancer will not perform their specific function to form keratin. Now when we talk about the cancer cells, they will lose the growth controls. They become genetically unstable. And when they replicate again, they will develop new mutations. Also, they will show their cardinal sign of invasion and metastasis. Now, when we talk about the clinical and the gross appearance, clinically, the benign tumors are slow growing and asymptomatic, whereas malignant tumors will present themselves in the form of rapid growth, in the form of ulceration, or there can be systemic symptoms such as weight loss, anorexia, anemia. All these can be appreciated in a malignant tumor. Now, when we talk about the cardinal features, we have to keep in mind that invasion and metastasis are considered to be the cardinal clinical signs and symptoms for malignancy. So, whenever it has been asked what is the cardinal sign for malignancy, it is the invasion and metastasis, which is not seen in cases of benign tumors. Now, when we talk about the gross appearance, anything which is benign will be spherical, will be well circumscribed, freely movable, it is firm, it is uniform, and it is not fixed to the underlying structure. Whereas, if it is malignant, it will be irregular, it will be poorly circumscribed, it will infiltrate or invade into the adjacent structures. Either it is non-capsulated or it is partially capsulated. It will show papillary, fungating, hemorrhagic, ulcerative areas. So, this is the difference table between the benign and malignant tumors. When we see the benign tumors, they are well circumscribed, the surrounding tissues are compressed, the size is small, whereas the malignant tumors will be poorly circumscribed, they will be irregular, they show invasion into the surrounding structures, and usually they are larger in size. When we see the microscopy of benign tumors, the NC ratio is normal, there is less hyperchromatism, mitosis is there, but usually typical mitosis. Chromosomal abnormalities are less frequent. Whereas in cases of malignancies, there will be loss of priority, there will be cellular nuclear pleomorphism, there will be altered NC ratio, there will be vesiculated hyperchromatic nuclei, there will be tumor giant cells. All these things can be appreciated in your malignant tumors. When we talk about the growth, usually benign tumors are slow intermittent growth, whereas the malignancy will show rapid growth. And invasion and metastasis can be appreciated in cases of malignancy. Now, when we talk about the morphology of neoplastic cell, there are two terms which are significant in cases of malignancy. The first is the differentiation. Second is the anaplasia. So, when we talk about the differentiation means a cell has perform its specific function to specialize something. For example, the stratified squamous epithelium differentiate to form keratin. So, whenever there is resemblance of the tumor cell to the normal cell, that time they are considered as well differentiated. Whereas the tumors which do not show structural and functional resemblance, they will be poorly differentiated or they will be undifferentiated. So based on this, the neoplasm can be categorized into three categories, the well differentiated, moderately differentiated and poorly differentiated. Also, there is another term that is anaplasia. Anaplasia means lack of differentiation. Whenever there is lack of differentiation, it is a hallmark of malignancy. So when we talk about the cardinal features, it is invasion and metastasis. And when we talk about the hallmark of malignancy, it is lack of differentiation. Also, there are features of anaplasia. They are similar to the features of dysplasia, but the grading or their appearance will be high. There will be more pleomorphism. There will be abnormal nuclear morphology. There will be abnormal atypical mitosis. There will be loss of polarity of the nucleus. And there will be formation of tumor giant cells. So we can appreciate in the photomicrograph the presence of pleomorphism. We can appreciate the cellular and the nuclear pleomorphism. The nucleus are hyperchromatic and also they show large Pijari shape. Also, there can be abnormal nuclear morphology in the form of shape. The chromatin can be condensed. There can be large nucleoli. There can be altered NC ratio and there can be hyperchromasia. So we can appreciate in the photomicrograph that there is abnormal atypical mitotic figures. Also, there can be hyperchromasia, there is altered NC ratio. When we talk about mitosis, in the normal cell proliferation, we can appreciate mitotic figures in the basal layer and the parabasal layer, whereas in cases of cancer or dysplasia, this mitosis can be appreciated in the superficial layer. So they are known as abnormal mitotic figures. Also, they can be atypical mitotic figures such as tripolar, quadripolar, and multipolar. So changes in the appearance of the nucleus will be a morphological feature of malignancy in the form of atypical bizarre mitotic figures. So in this photomicrograph, we can appreciate a tripolar mitotic figure. Also, there is a cytological abnormality because in the anaplastic cells, the tumor cells, there will be loss of polarity. So nucleus will be shifted away from the base. Also, in cases of tumor cells, there will be tumor giant cells. These giant cells are formed by the fusion of the normal cells. So they will fuse together and they will form giant cells. So we can compare the tumor cell from the normal cell in the features such as the loss of basal polarity, the pleomorphism, the NC ratio, hyperchromatism, abnormal mitosis, and the presence of tumor giant cells. So when we talk about the invasion and metastasis, we have to keep in mind through this schematic diagram. In the initial stages, there is primary tumor growth, which is within the epithelium, followed by there is breach in the basement membrane, which will lead to the invasion of the tumor cell into the neighboring tissue or in the surrounding stroma. Once the cancer cells has invaded, they will intravasate into the nearby blood vessels, and through this blood vessel, they will disseminate into the bloodstream to the different sites. So there will be extravasation of this tumor cell at a distant site, where they will start proliferating and form a secondary mass. And after that, there will be new blood vessel formation, that is angiogenesis, which will lead to the growth and proliferation of these tumor cells. Again, there will be distant metastasis. So in this schematic presentation, we can appreciate the invasion and metastasis of tumor cells from the normal epithelium to distant site, forming a secondary tumor. Also, there are various theories being proposed for the field cancerization, such as the first theory was given by Slaughter, who hypothesized that it is a multifactorial tumor which developed independently. So there are two different tumor masses which are developing at different site, and this is because of the exposure of the mucosa to the carcinogen, which can be tobacco or which can be any other chemical or it can be drugs. So because of which there is development of tumor mass at two different sites. The other theory was micrometastasis theory, in which it was hypothesized that the tumor cells metastasize with the help of the saliva from one site to the another. The third theory was the intraepithelial migration, that a cell which is being transformed will intraepithelially migrate from one site to another and will form the secondary tumor. It is the most accepted theory in the cases of field cancerization. Also, there is a progression model for cancer. It has been said that the oral cancer is because of the accumulation of the event and it is not a single cell procedure. So earlier there is normal mucosa which will undergo hyperplastic change. This hyperplasia of the epithelium is a normal phenomena. It is a protective phenomena because whenever there is the exposure of the mucosa to the carcinogen, so epithelium will try to form a protective layer. So there will be hyperplastic epithelium, followed by which there will be some dysplastic changes in the epithelium. Then there will be changes in the entire thickness of the epithelium, that but there is no breach, that is known as carcinoma in situ. Then there will be invasion and metastasis, and that is a cardinal sign for the development of cancer. So this is a proposed model for the progression of head and neck squamous cell carcinoma, and it is because of the accumulation of chromosomal and the genetic events which will lead to the development of cancer. So when we talk about the hallmarks of cancer, there are different hallmarks which is given by Hanahan. Earlier, there were six hallmarks which was given, which was categorized as the sustaining proliferative signal. That is, the proliferative signal will keep on going. There will be proliferation of these cells and they will attain a property of autonomy. Second, they will be evading growth suppressors. So those cells which causes the suppression of the gene, tumor suppressor gene, will be evaded. Third, there will be activation of invasion and metastasis. Fourth, there will be replicative immortality. That means the cell will not undergo death and it will lose the property of mortality. Also, there will be induced angiogenesis and there will be reduced apoptosis, that is resisting cell death. So these are the basic hallmarks of Hanahan, which was later revised by Hanahan as addition to the hallmarks, such as avoiding the immune destruction, dysregulating cellular genetics, tumor promoting inflammation, and genomic instability. So the six hallmarks, along with two emerging hallmarks and two enabling characteristics, were the fundamentals of or hallmarks of cancer. Now coming on to the histopathological grading system for squamous cell carcinoma, broader classify the squamous cell carcinoma into four grades. Grade 1 shows the tumor cells showing 75% differentiated cells. Grade 2, 50 to 75%. Grade 3, 25 to 50%, and grade 4, 25% differentiated cells. So they have graded them according to the differentiation. So the higher the grade, the less the differentiation. So this is the schematic presentation of broader differentiation, in which the grade 1 shows highly keratinized epithelium, so we can appreciate numerous keratin pulse along with individual cell keratinization. So more than 50% of the cell will show keratinization. So there will be more keratinization and there will be marked lymphoplasmacytic infiltration around the tumor cells. In the grade 2, there will be moderate keratinization, about 20 to 50%, and there will be moderate infiltration of the inflammatory cells. In grade 3, there will be minimal keratinization and about 5 to 20% of the cells show keratinization, and there will be less infiltration of the lymphocytes and the plasma cells. Whereas in cases of grade 4, there is either no keratinization or there is minimal keratinization and there is no lymphocyte plasmacytic infiltration is found in cases of grade 4. This grading system was further revised by WHO in 1972, which was further revised in 2005, and they have graded the cases of oral cancer into grade 1 as well differentiated, grade 2 moderately differentiated, and grade 3 as poorly differentiated. So, in this photomicrograph, we can appreciate the well-differentiated squamous cell carcinoma cases will resemble to their parent cell population, that is, the squamous cell differentiation. They will show numerous keratin pulse, they will show anaplastic features, and there will be individual cell keratinization. When we see the moderately differentiated squamous cell carcinoma, so there will be less resemblance to the parent epithelium in comparison to the well-differentiated cases, but and there is less keratinization also. However, in cases of poorly differentiated, there is either lack of differentiation or they do not resemble to their parent epithelium, and the differentiation or the presence of the keratin pulse is also reduced. So when we compare the histopathology of cases of well-differentiated to the moderate and the poorly differentiated cases, we can show difference in the pattern of keratinization, in the pattern of invasion, and also in the anaplastic features. So we can appreciate the histopathological presentation of all the different grades in highly differentiated carcinomas. There will be more keratin pulse, there will be more keratinization. In well moderately differentiated, there will be less keratinization, more atypical and normal features. However, in cases of poorly differentiated, there will be lack of differentiation, there will be round cell population with bizarre cell, bizarre nucleus, and there will be abnormal atypical mitotics. So this is a photomicrograph in which we can appreciate that in the one end there is a normal hyperplastic epithelium, and on the right side, there is invasion of this epithelium into the underlying tumor, underlying stroma, in the form of tumor islands, sheets, nests, cords. So the tumor mass is proliferating into the stroma. Also, there are numerous keratin pulse as we can appreciate in the tumor stroma. When we see the same in the high power view, we can appreciate that there are numerous keratin pulse which are surrounded by dense lymphoplasmacytic infiltrates. Now to summarize, when we talk about oral cancer has an etiopathogenesis from multiple factors. It can be because of the carcinogen in the chemicals, or it can be because of radiation, or it can be virus-induced. So whenever there is a stimulus from these agents to a normal cell, there will be DNA damage. So a cell has two features, either to undergo repair or failure of repair. So if the repair is successful, it will lead to a normal life. However, if the DNA damage is, repair is failed, it will undergo mutation. Whenever there is mutation in a cell, it will undergo proliferation in the form of tumor cell. There will be activation of the growth signal. There will be inactivation of the tumor suppressive signals. So it will lead to the unregulated cell proliferation. So there will be increased cell proliferation and there will be decreased apoptosis. All these findings will lead to the expansion of the clonal cells, and there will be further mutations as the cell replicate, and there will be angiogenesis. All these features will lead to the progression of the tumor mass, and there will be invasion and metastasis, which is a cardinal sign for malignancy. So oral cancer can has a multifactorial pathogenesis, which can be because of the chemicals, radiations, virus, tobacco. All these things can be seen in immunocompromised host because they can act as a precipitating factor for the progression of cancer. So to summarize the histopathology of oral cancer, we have different grades according to different authors, but according to WHO criteria, they have been categorized based on their keratinization pattern, invasion pattern, and on the basis of the presence of the keratin pearls in the stroma. So they are well keratinized, moderately keratin differentiated lesions, and they are poorly differentiated squamous cell carcinoma cases. So these are the MCQs. Please attempt the MCQs and write the answers in the comment box. Thank you.